And you mind me asking how you go about meeting new people every day?
Yeah, I mean, you got to put yourself out there, right? But number two, you got to know what you're looking for. I mean, it's just like when people raise capital, right? They're like, well, do you want to raise capital? They go, yes, right? Like, who doesn't want to raise capital, right? Especially to buy real estate. And I go, okay, so who is your ideal client? They're like, I don't know.
What are the three things that make you unique, your unique selling proposition? Can you go over those three things?
So my three questions were, you know, what's your strategic advantage, right? So what makes you stand out? Who is your ideal client? And number three is, what is your irresistible offer?
What about the market, Daniel? What are your thoughts on the real estate market? Is the real estate market going to go up? Is it going to go down? Is it going to crash and burn?
First and foremost, when's the last time in the history of the U.S. that we've had high inflation? We've had 0% interest rates in the Fed. We had over $8 trillion in the Fed balance sheet. We had over $1 trillion in the reverse repo market. And while all that is happening, we have stocks that are extremely overpriced. Real estate is extremely overpriced in certain markets. And at the same time, our president just signed a $1 trillion infrastructure bill.
Hi, everybody. This is Jose Luis Morales. Welcome back to the Morales Group Show. Today, we've got a very special guest. His name is Daniel Kwok. He is based out of Chicago, Illinois. He is a real estate investor, a real estate educator, and also a serial entrepreneur, somebody that owns multiple businesses. We're going to be taking a trip on his journey of how he went from zero to 75 units in 1 year. We're also going to be talking about how he helps clients pay off their mortgage sooner. And then we'll also touch a little bit on the real estate market as well, too. What is the real estate market doing? I know that a lot of people have questions about that. So this is an episode you don't want to miss. Daniel, welcome to the show. How are you?
Thanks for having me on, man. And by the way, very impressed with the pronunciation of my last name. You nailed it.
I was a little bit nervous about it, to be honest, just because it's not one that you see every day.
Yeah, I wish I had a name like Smith, right? It would have been super easy.
Or Jose Luis Morales.
Yeah, there you go. Right. Much more intricate.
Before we get into the podcast, I just want to remind our viewers that if you've enjoyed some of our previous episodes, make sure to hit that like and that subscribe button. So Daniel, let's just start off with, who is Daniel Kwok and how did you happen to come across the real estate investment world?
The way I got into real estate is it never gets old. I never get bored telling it. So hopefully people never get bored hearing it. So I remember when I was a little kid, and by the way, I'm an immigrant. So I immigrated from South Korea when I was 5 years old to the United States. Well, do you want the interesting version or do you want the quick version?
Give us the interesting
version. All right, you got it, man. You got it. So I remember when I was in Korea, and I'll try to make this as quick as possible. I was a huge basketball fan. So I had a cousin, an older cousin who played for his high school team, and he was pretty good, you know? And so we would always go watch him play. And I used to watch and, you know, enjoy watching the Korean basketball league, the KBL, thinking that these guys were like the best players in the world. And so I remember we immigrated. It was a 14-hour plane ride. And the entire time I'm like, oh, I'm going to miss my friends and I'm going to miss basketball because I don't think that there's going to be basketball in the United States. Right. And so we moved to America because my dad was and still is a preacher. And so, you know, he got asked to start a church or take over a church organization here in local Chicago. And so I get off the plane and we're at the gate. And I don't know if you remember, you definitely will. If I remember, you will. But do you remember those big box TVs that used to hang in the corner of the airports back in the late 90s? Uh-huh. So I remember we get off the gate and it's a Tuesday. I still remember this day, December 14th, I believe was the day. And we get off the plane. And I see the big box TV in the corner of O'Hare Airport. Mm-hmm. And there's a guy playing basketball. I'm like, oh, they got basketball here. Right on. Yeah. The guy was wearing a jersey that says number 23. And then, you know, he had his back to the basket and he jumped super high and he hit this fadeaway jumper. Wow, I never seen any of the Korean players do that. Uh-huh. His skin's a little darker than the Korean players. And I said to myself, I think that's my favorite player now. You know, there's basketball here. So maybe this place isn't so bad. And he's the first basketball player I saw. Well, you know, it's the late 90s. So it's obviously Michael Jordan, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
And so I was a diehard Chicago Bulls fan since I was a little kid. And so when I was 17 years old, I read an article by Forbes saying that out of the top 1% of individuals, 76% of those individuals made their money by investing in real estate. And where this whole story with the Chicago Bulls comes in is I looked up who the owner was. And it's this guy named Jerry Reinsdorf who bought the team in 1984 before Jordan got drafted. He bought the team, I think, for, I don't know how much what the price tag was, but the guy made his money investing in Chicago real estate. You know, around the same age, I read an article talking about real estate and I find out that the owner of my favorite team got his money by investing in real estate. So I was like, man, I got to get in the real estate game. And so that's how I got introduced to real estate. You know, my brother started a DJ company at the time, and that's how I got started with entrepreneurship. And, you know, I guess the rest you can say is history.
And by the way, it's funny that the first player that you saw was Michael Jordan, because you just saw the best right off.
That's right. The greatest of all time. That's right.
For my podcast, I'm starting a wall called the Goat Wall, and it's got an autographed jersey. I already bought the autographed jersey of Michael Jordan as well, too.
Nice.
So I'm a big fan of Jordan as well. What I wanted to ask you is, on your first deal, did you end up buying like a large apartment complex? Did you end up buying like a condo? Did you end up using an investor 20% down loan? Did you end up using a first-time home buyer loan? Do you remember what that deal looked like?
Yeah, I still remember it to this day. You know, when I first got started in real estate, I was 18 years old and I had negative $187.65 in my bank account. By the way, my family, we grew up poor. When I say poor, I mean poor, right? Like we lived next to when we first came to America, we lived in a studio apartment. We lived next to what's known as let's call it a gentleman's entertainment center. And my mom and my dad shared I still remember it to this day, like they shared a twin size bed in a room that doubled as their bedroom, that also doubled as our dining room, our living room, and our kitchen. I mean, you know, many nights we had to sleep in our car because we couldn't pay the heating bill. I liked going to school. It meant I was going to eat, you know? So when you grow up poor, a lot of times you learn poor. And if you're listening to this podcast and you're a parent, be careful not to teach your kids poor. So I'm 18, you know, negative that number in my bank account, had a couple maxed out credit cards and just felt like a loser, right? But I knew I wanted to get into investing and wanted to learn how to, you know, not for my own sake. Like I'm a very simple guy. Like I do very well for myself financially, but I still drive a Hyundai. My wife and I live in a 3-bedroom apartment. I don't have any Rolexes on my wrists or anything like that, but I wanted to always just build schools and hospitals and help people out, you know, create, be a ripple effect and inspire other individuals. And so, you know, I'm at that age and I see myself as a failure because I want to accomplish all these things, yet I can't even take care of myself, right? My inspiration led to my pursuit of information. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what a lot of people need to have. They need to have the inspiration be the pursuit of their information. So I just studied my butt off. Like I would get up at 6, 7 a.m. in the morning. I wouldn't go to sleep till midnight. And the entire time I would just study real estate. In terms of getting a loan, right, 20%, I couldn't do that because who in their right mind is going to give a, you know, 20, 18, 19-year-old kid with no real income, with debt, negative balance on his bank account? Like no one's going to give that kid a commercial loan. There's just no way. I learned about this thing called seller financing. For those that don't know, it's when the seller carries the note as opposed to the bank. So I learned how to do that. I perfected it, found ways to be very creative and get people to want to do it as opposed to me having to push it. I raised capital, you know, recruited some investors, which that in itself is another story, and got 87 doors in 1 year.
That's awesome. That's like really inspiring to hear that. And you did it at a pretty young age. I wanted to dig deeper on two things that you said. One of them is teach poor. I love that because I feel like almost unconsciously people inherit that mentality at no fault to their parents. I want you to dig a little bit deeper on that. And then the other thing I wanted you to dig a little bit deeper on was you said that you were studying a lot. Like what were you studying basically at that time?
So what I was studying at the time is just anything I could get my hands on. So I would listen to every podcast, read every book. You know, I would go to every single networking event I possibly could. I was going to probably about 3 or 4 networking events a week. You know, and just following up with people, you know, I would go as far as to even, I one time asked a property manager for 3 years, I worked for a property manager for free, you know, and made that individual millions of dollars. You know, I made them very rich and just worked for free just because I wanted to learn the game, learn the ropes. And, you know, people have to be willing to do that. You know, people are always like, oh, well, I learn by doing, so I should partner with you. Meaning that, hey, I'm not going to do anything. I'm going to learn, but you're going to do a bunch of stuff and I'm going to make some money off. No, right? Like I was willing to go at the base level and start at the bottom. So I was, you know, again, learning how to underwrite deals. I was learning what it means to structure capital. For me, I don't know. I feel like people don't understand perspective. Like if you really think about it, Jose, like we're living in a, like the, think about this. We have a device that can tell us anything we want to know, right? And we live in the United States of America. There is no better time and a place in history to start a business or to be in real estate. Even the most powerful emperors and kings of mankind did not have access to what we have access to today. There's 18, 19-year-old kids who are making millions of dollars off of digital art right now. So it's just perspective, right? So that perspective is what really kind of drove me to want to learn everything. The information's out there, right? Like it's all out on YouTube. It's all out on, you know, and I spend money on courses. You know, I still remember back then, my brother and I, we called our credit card company and we begged them to increase the line so we can buy a bunch of real estate courses. And so I don't know. I think that's just really, really important. You know, that education, you know, like I'm a big advocate of coaching and courses. And I've met people who are like, oh, like it's not worth the money. You know, why would you want to spend money on a coach when you can just spend that money on a down payment? And, you know, to those individuals, here's what I say. I say, look, man, you're either going to pay for education in here or you're going to pay for it out there in the market. And the cost of education out there in the market is way more expensive than you learning it from a course or a coach. And I want to touch on what you said about growing up poor, right? Like learning poor. So one of the things I'm really grateful for my parents is, you know, although we were poor and we didn't learn anything about, you know, finances, we didn't learn anything about, you know, I like most people, we never talked about money. Well, let's think about why money is never a topic of conversation around the dinner table. Well, it's because chances are the parents don't know anything about it either. If anything, they're intimidated by that topic. And because they're intimidated, they don't want to bring it up. And a lot of times when people get intimidated or it's an area that they're not really comfortable talking about, they tend to shy away from that conversation. And that cycle happens again and again and again and again. That's kind of what I mean by growing up poor. It's stuff that I had to really just re-engineer my brain in terms of how I think about money. And that's what a lot of people miss too, right? It's like before you can make a lot of it, you have to rewire the way you think about it.
What would you say was a driving factor for you? Meaning like, obviously you came from a family that didn't really have much. Did you meet somebody early on in your life that you looked up to that maybe said, hey, look, this is the difference between being poor and being rich. Did you read a book? Because I know for a lot of people, they're almost psychologically trapped based on what they see growing up. And it's almost like a vicious pattern that they never get out of. And that mentality, you inherit it sometimes. But even the fact that you said that you work for somebody for free, yeah, just to get the knowledge, it's something that is so rare now in days. People are always like, what's in it for me versus, hey, what can I give in exchange for knowledge? You know? So was there somebody in your life early on that kind of, that maybe you saw or a book that you read, or what was sort of that thing that early on motivated you to kind of say, hey, look, I want to go in a different direction?
I'd say I'm not a very motivated individual. Like I'm just not, you know what I mean? Like, do I work hard? Yes. But I don't know. I just, for me, motivation isn't really that great. Like, it's a temporary state of mind. So I guess I'll share a story that my mentor shared with me. And there wasn't really any one person, right? Like, I mean, I'm a follower of Jesus, so I guess that would be the answer. But I've always looked up to who I could be in 5 years, right? Like, that's who I always looked up to. But yeah, I guess I'll share the story that really kind of, it actually changed my life. I mean, now that I kind of think more about it. So it was January 1st of 2017. And I remember I was talking to my mentor at the time. And my mentor is a really sharp guy. You know, at one point he owned and managed, I think, 16,000 units of condos, right? Like, this guy was a giant whale. I don't know if he was a billionaire, but he was very close to it. You know, I told my mentor, I was like, hey, I wanna have 20 rental doors by the end of the year. Like, that's my goal, right? I'm gonna do it. My mentor very wisely just, you know, smiles and nods, like, okay. He tells me, Daniel, I'm gonna share something with you that, you know, someone shared with me and it made me a very rich man. And he goes, Daniel, never set goals, but always set standards and expectations. And I said, like, interesting, like, what does that mean, right? He goes, well, like, so many people, like, think about this, right? It's the New Year's resolution, right? Like, everybody says, well, I'm going to lose 20 pounds and do all this. Like, how many percentage of people actually fulfill their New Year's resolutions?
Rare, yeah.
And I'm like, probably like, what, 2%, if that? He's like, yeah, okay, studies show that 97.1% by the time it's April 1st, they've given up on their New Year's resolution. Same thing with businesses, right? We all know the statistic, within 5 years, 95% of businesses fail. And then my mentor goes, well, that's because everybody romanticizes the goal, but nobody romanticizes the standards and expectations. So what I did is what my mentor kind of walked me through and what I help my coaching clients do now is, what do they want to achieve? And let's reverse engineer four, five, six, seven, however much we have to, let's reverse engineer the steps we have to take to get there. And then let's go ahead and refine our most high efficient, highest best use action steps. So I'll give you a perfect example. Like I mentioned, seller financing and creative financing was the cornerstone on how I built my portfolio. For me, I didn't have a choice, right? Like I didn't have money laying around. I wasn't no rich kid son, right? So I knew I had to do seller financing. So I sat down at an empty desk and I get distracted very easily. I still remember I went to the library. And so I went into one of the quiet conference rooms, you know, those study rooms that they have at the library. And I just sat down, I grabbed a notepad, you know, very similar to this one right here. And then I said, okay, I got to buy property seller financing. What are the benefits of the owner doing seller financing? Not my benefit, not what's in it for me, but what is the win-win, right? So I just wrote down, I spent an entire week just thinking about different ideas, right? Like, okay, potential tax deferment. You know, they make money as the bank. They get to mitigate some of the costs at closing. And I just made a list. I think I made a list of about like 12 to 15. And I asked around, I asked my mentors, colleagues, peers, you name it. The next question I asked myself, again, another step of reverse engineering, I asked myself, okay, who are the individuals that would most resonate with all of these value propositions, all of these benefits that sellers get from seller financing? Who are the people that would resonate? And the answer I got was older landlords. So older landlords would resonate the most because why? They owned their buildings for more than 27 and a half years, which means they got a really big depreciation recapture event happening at closing. Not to mention that if they owned it for a long time, what does real estate tend to do over a period of time? Goes up. So I knew that not only were they going to have a pretty serious ordinary income tax event, but I knew that they were going to have to pay a pretty sizable capital gain tax as well. Sure enough, right? Older landlords. And I asked around different individuals that I knew in my network. And you know, they confirmed a lot of these things for me. And then I went to the next step, which is, okay, how do I best find these older landlords? Probably not going to be through technology, mm-hmm. right? But more so it's going to be through kind of your old school belly to belly form of marketing, right? So I did three things. Number one is I started calling signs out in front of the multifamily units. So every multifamily unit, right, they advertise their empty unit in some way, shape, or form. Mm-hmm. I noticed that a lot of the older generations were advertising their empty units by having a sign out in the lawn, right? It says for rent, and then there was a phone number on the bottom, right? I mean, you've seen those. Yeah. I see those all the time. So what I used to do is I used to spend 3-4 hours every single Saturday calling, driving around and calling those signs. And I would just simply say, hey, my name is Daniel Kwok. I'm a local real estate investor. I saw your for rent sign, and I just wanted to see if you'd be interested in selling. And I do that for 3-4 hours. So that was one way. Another way is newspaper ads. Spent another couple hours every single week calling newspaper ads. And then third, not only that, I built relationships with property managers that were 50 and above. There's a terminology known as the good old boys network, yeah. right? And a lot of people use it as an excuse, as a barrier as to why they're not successful. Well, guess what? I mean, that's no different than what you're doing. Think about it. Like if you and your friends have a party, you only know half the people there, you're probably going to talk to the people that you know first.
Yeah.
It's the same thing, right? So those individuals, they're going to do business with people they've known for 20, 30 years. It's not their fault. It's just the way human beings are wired, right? So for me, I asked myself, well, how can I take it to my advantage, right? How can I use it to my advantage and help build my career? So I started building relationships with old property managers. And what I did is I asked them, hey, how would you like to have a way where you never lose business ever again? So Jose, if you're a property manager and I go up to you, I says, Jose, how would you like to have none of your units ever be lost ever again?
It's a great value proposition to me because and the way to do it would be that you're going to keep, if they refer it to you, you're going to keep it under management with them.
That's exactly what I did.
They're inclined yeah. to refer it to you because now they never lose the units. If they sell 100%. It to somebody else, they're going to lose it.
100%. So I'd ask them, hey, like what's the, and I would start the conversation by asking them, hey, like what's the minimum amount of units you have to have under management for you to stay in business? And they go, oh, like 150, 75, whatever that number was. And I said, okay, where are you at right now? And I'm at 186. I'm at 198. I'm at 216, right? And I say, okay, great. So if you had one client that were to sell and you lose the management account, would you go out of business? They go, yeah, I go pretty close to it. So that's exactly what I did. I'd say, hey, how would you like to have an arrangement where, you know, next time you have a client that wants to sell, have them call me. Because if you're a good enough manager and you say you are, most people say they will, I'll just have you be the manager. And it worked out in my favor because I was able to actually verify all the expenses because they're the ones managing it. They had all the numbers. I knew exactly how that property was going to perform as opposed to having to rely on the offering memorandum or the P&L statement that the seller provides, which 99% of the time they're lying to you because at the end of the day, they want you to pay as high of a price as possible. So of course that NOI is going to be a lot lower than what it actually is. So on average, the offering memorandum expense ratio is 36% nationwide. The average expense ratio for a multifamily class B or a class C was 47.3%, meaning that there's an 11.1% disparity in what the perceived expenses are and what the actual expenses are. That 11% will kill investors. Even 2% will kill investors. So I found a way to really, you know, get honest answers out of property managers. So that's what I started doing. I started building relationships with them. And sure enough, I found a lot of older landlords. And sure enough, they really liked what I had to say, you know, with seller financing. And that's how I closed a lot of my deals. And, you know, it was simple, right? Put 10% down, 5% down. And I was able to acquire these properties very differently than what most people did.
I love the fact that you actually reached out to people and made the phone calls. And now people could even do it digitally. Like I know for us, we call people that are for rent by owners, meaning that people that are on Zillow but don't have a property management company. And just like you, some of these people are whales, meaning like they own 10, 15, 20 properties and they just like to self-manage. The other benefit that I was thinking for the landlord is that a lot of these older landlords, they want the cash flow, but they don't want the management anymore. Meaning that like they want that. So that's another value proposition for our viewers. They want the cash flow, but they don't want the management. And with seller financing, they get to keep the cash flow, but they also get rid of the management as well too. Let's talk about like the way that you reverse engineer goals for your clients. So whenever you had the goal for the 75 units, I know that you talked about the activities that you had to do, meaning would it go as far as saying part of that process, you have to do these activities for these amount of days, or can you dig a little bit deeper as to what that looks like? Because I think that's a principle. Like I'm thinking about it. Somebody sets a New Year's resolution to lose 180 pounds, but I don't think that they set like, okay, it's going to require Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday that I work out here. It's going to require this diet or this calorie deficit. So can you dig a little bit deeper on that?
The action steps that I created, right? So the reverse engineering led to the action steps. The action steps were, hey, call for rent signs, look at newspaper ads, build relationships with property managers. So these were what known as my KPIs, right? My key performance indicators. And I had 8 things. I had 5 things I would do every single day. I had 3 things that I would do every single week. I had 1 thing I would do every single month. So a total of 9, right? So 5 things I would do every day, 3 every week, and 1 every month. To make sure the ball is moving forward. And so what I would do is like, hey, by the end of the year, I want this. Okay, I got to get this done by this quarter. I got to get this done by this month. And I got to do this one by today. And most people don't do it because they're like, oh, later, 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 right? There's always tomorrow. But what it allowed me to do is it allowed me to have a pace. I was obsessed with this, right? I actually remember reading an article by Michael Phelps and somebody was like, hey, why are you the most decorated Olympian of all time? Right? One of the greatest athletes to you know, be in planet Earth. And he says, well, it's because for most people, their best day is my standard. That's what he would say. I was blown away by that. And even the greatest entrepreneurs of today, you know, guys like Warren Buffett and, you know, Cassie Woods and Bill Ackman and, you know, all these guys, right? You look at their daily habit, you know, and I was watching a documentary by Warren Buffett, how he reads 4 hours a day. So think about the amount of people, entrepreneurs and kids in their 20s who, if they read 4 hours a day of business book, they would take a selfie, put it on Facebook, Instagram, like, oh, look at me today. I read 4 hours, you know, did this, did that. And, you know, the old man's over there in their corner is like, dude, I do this every day, kid. So for me, that was the thing I did every single day. It was, I made it my standard. You know, it didn't matter if it was Christmas, Thanksgiving, Easter, you know, Boxing Day, whatever, right? Like I would do these things every single day, the success compounded, you know, and that's why a lot of people go, hey, like, how'd you do all this by the time you were 23 years old? Well, you know, it's just math, right? Like, because not only did I work hard in terms of consistency, but I also work smart in taking the time. And that's another thing I would say is make sure you take the time to ensure that the action steps that you're taking is the highest efficient, the smartest thing that you could be doing. Having a coach, having a mentor, is just, that's a pivotal part of that process.
You mind me asking how you landed the whale of a mentor? Like, is there a story behind that? Is that the same guy that you worked for free as well too, that you made millions, or how did
So it was a different guy. And so I always say, if you're intentional, your network will always expand itself. Mm-hmm. You know, so if you're intentionally looking to network with other people, which I learned that lesson when the first time I met a billionaire, so I remember I was sitting down at a really nice restaurant. I was sitting with an investor who had a lot of money. All of a sudden he goes, "Hey, Daniel, have you met a billionaire?" I go, "No." He goes, "Well, you're about to." So he goes, "Hey, Mark, come over here." Right. And it wasn't Mark Cuban. Right? That's not the billionaire you're thinking of. But he goes, "Hey, Mark, come over here." Right. He goes, "Hey, you know, I want you to meet this kid. You know, he's 22 years old. He's very wide eyed. He's a hard worker. He's going to be somebody." And so, you know, I go, "Hey, how are you, sir?" You know, and I ask him, like, I have to ask, out of all the people who are rich, right, there's a lot of millionaires in America. Why are you a billionaire? You know, like, stuff that it drives me. It obsesses. Actually, you know, every time I meet an NBA player or an NFL player, I ask the same thing. It's like, "Hey, there's a lot of kids who play in college, who play in high school. You know, you're not size-wise, you're not, you know, that much different. Why are you in the NBA? Why are you in the NFL?" And so this guy answered me. So, "Daniel, millionaires focus on ideas, execution, strategy. You know, they focus on all sorts of things, you know, habits. You know, you can go down the list, right? The amount of hours you read in a day, discipline, whatever." He goes, "I did all those things, don't get me wrong. But what I focused on above all else, number one, was networking. And then creating strategic partnerships with people in my network." Wow. So as in, give them a reason to want to network. There's this phrase that goes around that goes, "It's not what you know, it's who you know." Yeah. It's a good statement. But I think it only covers half of the real story, which for me, I love the variation, right? It was Robert Herjavec I heard it from, the guy from Shark Tank. Mm-hmm. And he goes, "Yes, right, it's not what you know, it's who you know. However, your what you know should make you the person that everybody wants to get to know." As in, what reason are you giving them to want to network with you? So when it comes to the networking game, you yourself are a product. Are you a good product or you're a bad product? Well, there's competition all the time, right? So when we're talking real estate agents, right? And I know a lot of the people who listen to your audience are real estate agents and brokers. When I think of a real estate agent, I think of not just one person, I think of many people. So you're talking about a competition. So for me, it's if I go, well, if I want to stand out from the competition, then all the great companies know how to do it, right? They know three things. And by the way, I always, whenever I buy into a business and I do that, I passively invest into other companies, and you know, I own different companies outside of my own companies. I always ask them three questions. Number one is, what is your competitive advantage, right? What stands you above the rest? Number two, who is your ideal client? And number three, what is your irresistible offer? Every business I know that has answered these questions clearly and execute them, I've never seen them fail. Every single one of them, 10x their business, right? If they carry on that concept. So it's the same thing if you're a realtor or a broker. If you ask those three questions, what is my competitive advantage? Especially when it comes to networking, right? Like when I think of networking, I know hundreds of real estate agents and brokers, right? Because of, you know, my YouTube channel and who I am, right? Like there's a lot. There's a lot of people who want to get to know me and whatever. I think of one guy when I think of realtors. There's a lot, but there's one that stands above the rest. And this guy has done things to go above and beyond and over deliver that he has eliminated the competition in my mental real estate. You know, I think doing that is super duper important. So the way I met my mentor was simply that. I found ways to stand out, right? I found ways to stand out and create value for individuals. And sure enough, one guy goes, "Hey, you really ought to meet this guy. You know, his name is Mike. You know, he's an older dude, but at one point he owned this, this, and this. And I think with where you're going, you know, I think he would be very much of a benefit." I meet new people every day, man, you know, because of how important I deem it to be.
And you mind me asking how you go about meeting new people every day? Like, is it just through the social aspect that you're doing through social media? Is it attending certain events, certain real estate groups? What does that look like?
Yeah, I mean, you got to put yourself out there, right? But number two, you got to know what you're looking for. I mean, it's just like when people raise capital, right? They're like, "Well, do you want to raise capital?" They go, "Yes," right? Like, who doesn't want to raise capital, right? Especially to buy real estate. And I go, "Okay, so who is your ideal client?" They're like, "I don't know, somebody that just has money." Well, that's the problem right there. Because for me, I'm not looking for all the investors. I'm looking for the right ones. So it's the same thing with networking, right? So a lot of the biggest mistakes that people make in networking is they just want to network with anybody that's successful. That's the biggest mistake that anybody can make in networking, because not only are you networking with the wrong person, but you now have an opportunity cost of meeting somebody who would have actually helped you anyways. So, you know, time is a currency. We want to protect it. So number one, you got to put yourself out there. But number two is you got to know who you want to network with. So one of the things that I do all the time is every month I make a list of three types of people that I need to network with that month. So, and then build relationships with. So I'd say a third thing that really helps me is intentionality. I mean, text messages, dinners, coffees, you name it, you know, lunch. A really good way to network is have your list of what's in the centers of influence. So centers of influence are people who know everybody. I got a good friend of mine who I actually met him by me being on his podcast show. And I found out there's a lot of similarities and we just hit it off. I got a good friend named, his name is Troy. He is a perfect example of a center of influence. Like the guy knows everybody, everybody from Dana White to Steve Wynn to Tony Robbins. And to, I mean, the guy knows everybody. He's got a very extensive network. Him and I are very good friends. And, you know, it's not a transactional relationship, but I just genuinely love and want to serve the guy. And when you do that, people like that tend to reciprocate. You know, for me, it's not about, I want to meet people. I want to meet as high a status of the whatever. I just see people as who they are, you know? So I'm interviewing a guy tomorrow. You know, a lot of people know his name. It's a guy named Grant Cardone. So him and I are doing a podcast tomorrow. And truth be told, I'll be honest, you know, I don't see him as any different than someone like you or me or whatever. I'm not as famous as Grant Cardone, but at the end of the day, he's got stuff that he wants to push and everybody's got things that they want to drive and whatnot. And I think if you really understand what people want and what drives them, I think it makes networking a lot easier.
And then you said that you asked basketball players that one question as to what made them different. Do you mind me asking what like a typical response is? And then what is maybe the best response that you've ever heard that was like, wow, like this really stood out to me?
Out of all the athletes that I've asked, like a lot of the pro athletes, there's one answer that really kind of caught me off guard, but the more I thought about it, the more I was like, wow, that is so true. So obviously the typical answers are like, hey, like work hard, be consistent, you know your fundamentals, whatever. But there was one time this NBA player, I asked him, he doesn't play in the NBA anymore, but I asked him like, hey, like what got you to the dance? What got you there? And he goes, Daniel, like one of the things I always did was build a great relationships with the people that mattered to me when it comes to decision-making time. What he meant by that is, you know, in college, he built a great relationship with coaches because at the end of the day, you know, a lot of the NBA scouts, they talk to the coach and they're like, hey, who's on your squad that I should be looking at? And then the coach would always go, oh, you got to look at Bobby. You know, he's a great player, but he's got a great heart. He's got a great work ethic. It's going to translate well into the next level. So he would always build relationships with people like that who knew were going to be part of his decision, who knew had influence in terms of getting to that next level.
Yeah.
So that was one answer that really blew me away. Because even when you're talking about the topic of networking, you want to elevate your network, right? I mean, you want to treat people the same, don't get me wrong, right? Like even today, I'll treat my investors who have billionaire status the same people as the people who put in $100,000 in my fund. And we want to love them and serve them the same way in terms of how we show up. But if you're talking about, you know, networking with different individuals, there are different tiers, right, of entrepreneurs, right? There's levels to this investment game, just like how there's levels to the game of basketball, right? You have your high school player, your college player, you have like D1, D2, D3, and then you have your overseas and you have the D League and then you have the NBA. And even in the NBA, you've got your starters and then you have your all-stars and then you have your superstars. And then, right. So there's levels to everything that we do. So for me is in the game of business, if I want to network with people in different tiers, it's going to require different things. So, you know, even stuff like, oh man, you really want to get to know this Daniel guy. You know, you really want to get to know this Jose guy. Man, this guy, he can deliver. These are the attributes that I look to improve in myself, you know, every single day.
So just basically becoming somebody that they'd want to hang out with, almost like reverse engineering it as well too. I was listening to something as like, oh, I can't find my ideal husband or my ideal wife. And it's like almost, you could almost reverse engineer it as well too. And would that person want who you are today? Meaning like if you want X, would X be attracted to who you are today? If not, you may have to develop yourself into somebody different. I'm curious about this question. Obviously, you've talked about like the three things that you ask business owners before you invest. What would you say your three things are to investors that you work with? Meaning like, what are the three things that make you unique, your unique selling proposition? Can you go over those three things?
So my three questions were, you know, what's your strategic advantage? Right. So what makes you stand out? Who is your ideal client? And number three is, what is your irresistible offer? So my fund, Miati Partners Capital, Our strategic advantage is that we spent 2 years studying the investment space in terms of what is offered, right? So there's platforms like a REIT, which is a real estate investment trust. There's a syndication model, right? There's hedge funds, you name it. And what we've done is we've taken the best from each and every world and we made little tweaks. And so the closest thing that we are is a syndication, but we made different tweaks to where when you're investing in a syndication, you're investing in one deal. But we actually created a fund, a platform where investors invest their money, they're secured and collateralized, not just by one property, but by multiple assets. Mm-hmm. So we're an ever-growing fund, meaning that we're constantly raising capital, meaning that we're constantly doing deals. But the beauty of it is the more we grow, the more the investor's risk gets mitigated because there's more and more assets that belongs in this pile, right? So that's our strategic advantage, is that we have a risk mitigated model that a lot of other real estate funds do not have, meaning that our investors are protected, you know, a lot better, in my opinion, than most other real estate investing products out there. So that's our strategic advantage. Our ideal client is the individual who is high net worth, but wants long-term growth and income. So meaning that this is the individual who puts their money in and they just watch it grow for 5-10 years. And they love diversification. They love tax advantages. And they love all the things that, you know, they love in real estate. We are not looking for the individual who wants to put money in and take it out 12 months later. That's not who we're looking for. We want individuals who want to focus on being wealthy, not just rich, you know. And then third, final, our irresistible offer is that we operate like a hedge fund, meaning that our investors actually own 100% of all the assets we acquire. So instead of like a typical syndication where the general partner takes 30% of ownership or 20% ownership or 40% ownership, we take zero. Our limited partners own 100% of the assets. So that's our irresistible offer, meaning they get 100% of the tax benefits, the growth, the appreciation. I mean, you name it.
So what would the benefit be to you guys then? Because I know in other syndications, they're taking a piece of the pie for finding the deal. What's the benefit to you guys?
So we have a fee structure. So we have a performance fee, right? And then we also have a management fee, which, you know, our 2% management fee is off of the capital raised, not the value of the property. We have an acquisition fee as well. So we, and don't get me wrong, it's a business, right? Like we're here to make money too. But what I like about our model is our fee structure puts us on the same side of the table as the investor. You know, whereas something with like a syndication or something else, right? I mean, just because the GP has ownership stake, they make money no matter what.
I love it, the fact that you analyzed all the different things, because you basically created a win-win for the partners and you created a win-win for the consumer as well too. That's one of the things I think as well too, just for anybody looking to do anything, just create something that is a win-win for everybody, you know, for the consumers as well as the partners as well too. And if you can think about the consumer and put yourself in their shoes, it's going to become a win-win situation. What about mistakes that you've done either through maybe having the wrong investor join your company or maybe just buying the wrong property? Like, what have been some of the challenges that you face along the way?
Honestly, the biggest mistakes I've made in the real estate game is introducing investors to other general partners. Mm-hmm. Right. So this one time I made a mistake of introducing a bunch of investors to somebody who was doing a bunch of fix and flips. I found out, you know, 4 or 5 months later that individual was doing things very unethically. And so, I mean, don't get me wrong. Like these weren't my deals. My name wasn't anywhere near the contracts. I just literally just made an introduction. Right. But kind of just put things in perspective. Right. Like a lot of these people I build a relationship with, these investors, they have faith in me. And because of it, they made a decision to follow this individual, right? And I gave them my stamp of approval. So I was like, ugh, it ended up badly. And I just realized that there are very few people I've learned in the real estate investing world that like actually understand that somebody is literally putting their life savings into your company and you better not screw it up, mm-hmm. right? But there's people who don't take that as seriously as I would, right? Or you would. So that's just tough. That's a mistake that I learned. So I'm very careful about introducing people to investors now. If I do, then you know I know exactly what they're looking for. I make sure all the paperwork's airtight and they're protected.
Do you still buy smaller deals, or is it mainly like larger deals now? Like, do you still buy like 1 to 4 units, or is it mainly commercial? And is there a preference and why?
Mainly bigger, just because for me, that's just the best way to serve my investors. Like the investors who put in $500,000 to $2 million, I mean, they're probably not going to be the biggest fans of me going out and buying a $100,000 single family house, right? That cash flow is $200 a month. For me, you know, I have more fun, let's put it that way, doing bigger deals than I do smaller ones. It's different. One's not harder than the other, I don't think. But yeah, I that's probably why I have a preference. I mean, truth be honest, I don't really need to do real estate. I do it because it's fun. And hopefully everybody listening to this podcast will be able to say that one day, right? Like, they don't have to do anything anymore. They just do things for fun. But yeah, that's why they're more fun for me. And that's a better way to serve my investors.
You mentioned earlier on in the podcast that you have a way for consumers to help them pay off their mortgage earlier. Do you mind kind of sharing a little bit of what that strategy looks like?
So my brother and I discovered this strategy back in 2014. It was 7 years ago. We found out because there was a guy who was from Australia. And this strategy was very popular in Australia, where, you know, a lot of people don't know how much money they lose just by having a traditional 30-year mortgage. I mean, to give you an idea, if you have here, let's just do the math. So I'll break out my mortgage calculator. Right. So let's say that you have the median sales price today in the United States is $375,000, around that ballpark. Right. So let's take property value of $375,000. You know, let's put a down payment of 20%. What's the interest rate today? You know,
let's just put 3.5%.
Okay. 3.5%. Right. And that's a very generous interest rate. Okay. So we got a 30-year mortgage. Okay. So your payment is $1,347.13 a month. Meaning that for the entire year, if the start date of your loan is January 1st, 2022, in the first year, you pay $5,757.38 in principal. In interest, you pay $10,408, meaning that you're paying twice the amount of interest almost as you are in principal the first year. And that's what's known as an amortization schedule. Now, keep in mind, if you don't refinance or if you don't move, at the end of those 30 years, you end up paying $185,000 just on interest. Now, statistics show that if you move or if you refinance, that number skyrockets from 185 to something much, much, much larger. Now, think about how many Americans refinance or move.
All the time.
All the time, right? Like, I think there's a statistic saying that the average American will move somewhere along like a 7 to 8 times in their lifetime. So you're talking about all this money that the bank is making on the interest on the front end. That's a big problem. And that's part of the reason why middle-class America has a hard time growing today. You know, it's because a lot of times these banking products are very disadvantaged to our average hardworking American. So what we have done is we've created a software and a product and a strategy that helps people combat that. And so we have clients who are saving tens of thousands of dollars in their interest and taking back their dream, right? Being able to put that money into their kids' college funds and, you know, putting that towards a better vacation or better Christmas gifts, you know. So we have a software that helps people automate that strategy. And then we also have team members who walk them through. And most importantly, we help people get educated. That way they can pass that on to their kids. So if people want to learn more about the strategy, we have a YouTube video on our YouTube channel. It's called How to Pay Off Your Mortgage in 5 to 7 Years. It's actually done by my brother, Sam. And so there's a 2021 version of it, I think, that people can go check out. But man, I would highly encourage it. It's one of the cornerstones, in my opinion, of financial literacy.
I love it. And it makes sense because the first couple of years, you're not paying a lot of principal. And then if you're refinancing, you're basically resetting it all over again where you're paying off. I didn't think about that 100%. What about the market, Daniel? What are your thoughts on the real estate market? Is the real estate market going to go up? Is it going to go down? Is it going to crash and burn? What are your thoughts? I'd love to hear them.
Yeah, we're all doomed right now. I'm kidding. I don't know. I have a different take on what a lot of people are saying about the real estate market. First and foremost, when's the last time in the history of the U.S. that we've had high inflation? We've had 0% interest rates in the Fed. We had over $8 trillion in the Fed balance sheet. We had over $1 trillion in the reverse repo market. And while all that is happening, we have stocks that are extremely overpriced. Real estate is extremely overpriced in certain markets. And at the same time, our president just signed a $1 trillion infrastructure bill. I can't think of another time in the history of the US that all that has ever happened at the same time, right? So the fact of the matter is, I do not know. I don't have a crystal ball. I wish I did, right? Otherwise, I'd be much more successful than I am today. But I think at the end of the day, you know, a lot of people are saying crash. A lot of people are saying that the prices are going to stabilize. Some people are saying they're going to continue to go up. I think the people who are saying that it's going to go up maybe are looking at the wrong data. So let's take a look at this one, right? So since we're both in real estate, a lot of people are saying right now that there's a huge housing shortage and there's a, you know, there's a big foreclosure wave coming. Well, maybe there is, maybe there's not, right? I know one thing's for sure. My generation, the millennials, would greatly appreciate if there's a new foreclosure wave coming. because it means a lot of new homes re-entering the inventory. I think all of this affects apartment complexes more than single family homes, because right now you have developers who are creating and developing projects in areas that are based off of false rental trends. And what I mean by that is, you know, even my home state of Illinois, in my area that I'm in, we have a $600 increase over the last 18 months in apartment complex in rents. $600 increase. That's ridiculous. And the reason being, in my opinion, is because you have a lot of these individuals who are my age who are not able to enter the housing market. They're not able to enter home ownership. And because they're not, they're having to rent. They're having to go to the Class A apartment complex until the housing market either slows down, or B, they're waiting till their lease is over so they can move to a place like Tennessee or Florida or Texas. I mean, they're building thousands of units around where I live. If you actually draw a diameter or radius of 10-minute drive from my house, they're building something along the lines of 3,500 units, all of them being Class A. And they're building them based on this premise that rents have gone up $600 in the last 18 months, and they believe that it's on the current trajectory that it's in. Well, my question is once the housing shortage cools down and supply shortages stop and we have units re-entering into inventory and then rates go up, therefore, you know, decreasing the power of the current buying pool, you're going to have a lot of individuals my age who are either going to move out of the state or they're going to enter home ownership. And you're going to have a lot less of a rental pool than you thought from the beginning while having an increase in supply in new construction. So I don't know. I think for states like mine, Illinois, I don't think we're going to see maybe we will for a short time, but I think in the next, you know, 18 to 36 months, we actually might see a decrease in rent. And I think home prices are going to stabilize too in states like that. But in states like Arizona, Tennessee, Florida, and Texas, I wouldn't be surprised if they stabilize or they increase just slightly.
I have a theory, and I'll share it with you, because Ray Dalio says that you want to triangulate ideas with believable people and kind of get their opinion on it. The fact that the government has printed out so much money, I feel like it's almost a setup for the minimum wage being increased as well too. Like the federal minimum wage. And I know that there's talks of it, of the federal minimum wage going to 7 to 15 or something like that. If that were to happen, what impact do you see in the real estate market?
Yeah, if wages were to go up, not a lot. Because, I mean, if you think about it, you know, a rising tide raises all ships, right? So if you have a minimum wage at, you know, $15, $16, $18 an hour, then, you know, guess what the price of milk and gas is going to be, you know? So at the end of the day, I think we're talking, you know, numbers that really dictate the strength of the home buyer. You know, you're talking numbers like credit score, DTI.
Now they qualify for a lot more.
That's exactly right, you know? So their income might be higher, but you know, if you look at the history of human nature, I know a lot of people who just because they make more money, they spend more money. You know, we'll see.
I have a feeling that the minimum wage is going to go up substantially in the next 5 years to kind of hedge against all this inflation. And I think that's going to make the prices more sustainable. I personally believe that the houses didn't get more expensive, that the dollar has just lost a lot of value. And I think that has to do as well, too, with the minimum wage going up in the next 5 years. It's a prediction. I'm putting it out there. And the reason I'm putting it out there now is because I was talking about inflation in 2013, 14, and 15, and now it's here. I'm like, well, let's see if this actually follows through. I love to kind of get that way.
No, I agree. I mean, I had a friend of mine, a good amount of people know him, a guy by the name of George Gammon. He actually says that, you know, that's absolutely right. Home prices over the last 30 years have inflated as much as they've gone up in value. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I absolutely agree with you.
Anything else that you think would add value to our viewers or anything else that you like to touch on?
If they just want to say hi, they can just reach out to me. My email is Daniel at the Clock Brothers. That's actually my personal email. That's the one I check all the time. Uh-huh. So if people just want to say hi and, you know, just say what's up and, you know, ask a question, then, you know, I like connecting.
And just so you know, this is one of my favorite interviews. I love how detailed you are. And I love how much analysis you have done as well, too. And obviously, you're extremely financially educated as well, too. So I just want to say thank you for our viewers. If you enjoyed this interview, make sure to hit that subscribe button. If you saw value, make sure to share it with a friend. This was episode number 91 of the Morales Group Show. We had Daniel Kwok. He educated us on getting the right mentor, apartment complex, syndication, and just overall finance. So thank you so much, Daniel, for being on the show.
Thanks, Jose.
You and I look forward to staying in touch with you.